Due to popular demand, today we're taking a look at the VR performance of the RX 7900 GRE. And the very first game I tested the 7900 GRE with was Half Life Alyx. It's kind of crazy to me that this game came out 4 years ago and is still the best VR game out there. Now, for anyone that's watched one of my GPU VR performance videos before, you know I prefer visual fidelity over frame rate, so I will always sacrifice some FPS in favor of using a higher render resolution. I tell you this because if you're someone looking to buy the 7900 GRE or already own one and are wondering what kind of performance you can expect out of it in VR, I want you to know you do not have to use the same settings I do. Consider the settings I share in this video as a starting off point. If I'm running a game at 90 Hz or 72 Hz, but you're wanting 90 or 120, just know that is going to be possible, so long as you use a lower render resolution and probably game settings than what I end up using here. I just like my VR to look as sharp and clear as possible, which is why I go with the settings I do. Okay, back to Half-Life Alyx. If you're wanting to play Half-Life Alyx at 120 Hz with the 7900 GRE, you'll be happy to know I was able to run the game at 120 Hz at a render resolution of 4704 by 2528 using the Ultra Quality preset. But you should also know there is a little bit of nuance to this. Now, those of you who've watched my videos before know I use Quest headsets for all my testing, and there was something I noticed in Half-Life Alyx when running the game at 120 Hz versus 90 Hz. At 90 Hz, the visuals were sharper and clearer than they were at 120 Hz, even though I was using the exact same render resolution. This is, of course, due to the fact that the Quest uses an encoded video stream rather than getting a direct video feed via HDMI or DisplayPort. When I pulled up the Oculus Link info using the Oculus debug tool, you can see at 120 Hz, it was defaulting to a lower encode resolution of 3200 by 1728, whereas at 90 Hz, it defaulted to 4096 by 2240. I'm not saying the game looked bad at the lower encode resolution, but the visuals were noticeably softer, and by softer, I mean blurrier. I was able to overcome this though by manually setting the encode width in the Oculus debug tool to 4096, but later on as I was testing some other games I ran into a little problem with this, which we'll talk about in a bit. I've said it before, Half-Life Alyx isn't a super fast-paced game and doesn't need to be run at 120 Hz in my opinion, so if you're using a Quest and want the game to look as sharp as possible and don't want to mess with manually setting the encode width in the Oculus debug tool, then just go with 90 Hz, and the game will both look and play fantastically on the 7900 GRE. Other games I was able to play at 120 Hz at 4704 by 2528 with the in-game settings maxed out, or pretty close to it, were Beat Saber, Contractors, Breachers, The Walking Dead Saints and Sinners, Red Matter 2, and Pavlov. I ran all of these games with the encode width set to 4096 in the Oculus debug tool, and they all ran great, with the exception of Pavlov. While the performance graphs were telling me I had headroom still available and my frame rate was at 120 FPS, what I was seeing with my eyes did not look like 120 FPS. It looked like 60 FPS being reprojected up to 120 FPS. I then pulled up the Oculus Link info, and sure enough, the encoder frame rate was at 60. I then set the encode width in the Oculus debug tool back to default and fired Pavlov back up again, and that got us back to a true 120 FPS. So just know, if you force a higher render resolution using the Oculus debug tool like I did, there may be some games where this will adversely affect your gameplay experience. After experiencing this, I decided to keep the encode width at the default throughout the rest of my testing. For this video, I'm using the Gigabyte Radeon RX 7900 GRE Gaming OC16G, paired up with the Ryzen 7 7800 X3D and 32 GB of DDR5 running at 6600 megatransfers a second. For all my testing, I used AMD's most current 24.8.1 driver with resizable bar enabled, and the headset I'm using is the Quest 3, connected to my test PC via a link cable. The next game I took a look at was Lone Echo 2, and I actually had to lower the render resolution a little bit on this to 4480 by 2400, and the 7900 GRE was just barely able to maintain a constant 90 FPS in all the areas I test with in this game. As you can see here, I was super close to running out of performance headroom and dropping below 90 FPS, but the 7900 GRE was just able to squeak it out. As for the in-game settings, I was able to use the high preset, but had to lower the shadow quality to medium to keep our frame rate from dropping below 90. Comparing these results to what I saw when I tested the 7800 XT, all the settings were the same except for the render resolution. Now there is one fairly big difference from that video to this one, and that is in my 7800 XT video, I used a Quest 2 for my testing, and for this one, I'm using a Quest 3. Now going back a little bit, when I tested Beat Saber, Contractors, Breachers, and Red Matter 2, I noticed I had to lower some of the in-game settings by a notch or so with the 7900 GRE from the settings I used with the 7800 XT. At first this seemed a little odd, but after thinking about it, it made sense, because when using the Quest 3, since the resolution of its displays is higher than that of the Quest 2, the render resolution options in the Meta Quest Link app, formerly the Oculus PC app, is also different. For the Quest 2 in those games, I used a render resolution of 4704 by 2380. For the Quest 3, the vertical resolution is increased a little bit to 2528 when using the same width of 4704, which is a 6% increase to the total number of pixels being rendered. I know 6% doesn't sound like all that much, but in this case, it's a difference of almost 700,000 pixels. With the 7900 GRE only being 5 to 10% faster on average than the 7800 XT, depending on the game and resolution you're running at, I feel this bump in render resolution is just enough to negate the additional performance of the 7900 GRE and prevents us from being able to run games at the same settings as I did with the Quest 2 and 7800 XT. Just to verify this, I connected up my Quest 2, and as suspected, the 7900 GRE was able to hit the same settings as I did with the 7800 XT without a problem. When it comes to Lone Echo 2, though, I found it rather odd that I couldn't even run the game at 4704 by 2528 at 90Hz, because when using the Quest 2, the 7900 GRE had no problem running the game at 4704 by 2400. I did notice the Encode resolution on the Quest 2 is a fair bit lower than that of the Quest 3 though, so perhaps that has something to do with it? Even running at the slightly lower resolution of 4480 by 2400, the visuals look sharper and clearer on the Quest 3, even though the render resolution was set to 4704 by 2400 for the Quest 2. And this is because the Encode resolution defaults to 4096 by 2240 on the Quest 3, where the Quest 2 defaults to 3680 by 1920. So perhaps that higher encoding workload when using the Quest 3 is impacting our overall performance a little. I don't know. Anyway, I think we've spent enough time talking about that. Let's move on to the next game, shall we? The next game I took a look at was Ghosts of Tabor, and I was able to run this one at 4704 by 2528 at 80Hz using the in-game settings you see on screen now. This game has some pretty dramatic swings in the amount of load being put on your system depending on where you are, what you're looking at, and what you're doing. I did try running this game at 90Hz as well, and for the most part it ran fine, but during those occasional moments when the performance headroom drops way down, asynchronous space warp would kick in, cutting our frame rate in half, which is something I try to avoid in games like this, and lowering the refresh rate to 80Hz took care of that problem. After Ghosts of Tabor, I fired up Into the Radius, and the 7900 GRE handled this one quite nicely at 90Hz at 4704 by 2528. This was another game where the increased vertical resolution of the Quest 3 left me having to turn a setting down one notch lower than when using a Quest 2. I was able to set the resolution in the game settings to 110% when using my Quest 2. However, when using my Quest 3, I was only able to set it to 100%. Just like I mentioned with Lone Echo 2, despite turning the setting down a notch, visually the game looked better on the Quest 3 thanks to its pancake lenses and the higher encode resolution. But of course, this isn't a Quest 3 review, we're looking at the VR performance of the 7900 GRE. So I'll end this off by saying when using a Quest 3, these are the settings I ended up going with. Next up we have Assetto Corsa Competizione. And those of you that are familiar with this game know the absolute butt-ton of different settings there are to adjust. But to keep things simple, I just used the VR High preset and then turned the resolution scale up to 90% from 80% and turned the VR pixel density down one notch from 120% to 110%. And that allowed the 7900 GRE to run this game at a solid 90 Hz with a render resolution of 4128 by 2208. Since the last time I benchmarked Blade & Sorcery, the game has finally come out of early access and has officially launched. Some of the gameplay mechanics have changed a little bit, as have some of the available settings, but it still has all the fun spellcasting and swordplay it's always had. This is another one of those games where performance can fluctuate a lot depending on what you're doing, but the 7900 GRE was able to manage 90 FPS at my go-to resolution of 4704 by 2528. During fights with multiple NPCs, I did see the frame rate waver a bit from 90 here and there, but overall, the frame rate was very good, and I had a great time dismembering enemies and wreaking havoc with my magical powers. As I often do, I've saved Microsoft Flight Simulator for last, and for this one, I chose to take the refresh rate down to 72 Hz while running a render resolution of 3936 by 2112, using my typical in-game VR settings with the render scaling, world scale, terrain level of detail, and objects level of detail at 100, and everything else at their lowest values. At these settings, the 7900 GRE delivered a flawless 72 FPS in this training flight over Sedona, Arizona. And even when I quickly whipped my head from side to side, the frame rate hardly wavered at all. And when switching over to New York City, it gave us a pretty consistent 36 FPS. There was some fluctuation below 36 FPS, but as you can see, it was very, very brief and unnoticeable for the most part in the headset. Before I give my final thoughts on the 7900 GRE, I'm curious to hear what your thoughts are. Did it meet your expectations, or were you expecting more? Sound off in the comments and let me know what you think. Going back and comparing the results I got with the 7900 GRE with what I got out of the 7800 XT, the small performance increase on the 7900 GRE wasn't enough for me to be able to use settings any higher than I did when testing the 7800 XT. Going into this, I was really hoping the 7900 GRE would be a nice step up from the 7800 XT in VR, but that just isn't the case in the games I tested. As far as its performance is concerned, it certainly isn't bad, but when comparing its performance to the 7800 XT, which is at least $50 cheaper, depending on the make and model you're looking at, not being able to push the settings in any of my games any higher make the 7900 GRE a less compelling option for VR, in my opinion. Now, of course, VR isn't the only thing the 7900 GRE can be used for, so I don't think it's a terrible value at its current price. However, for anyone looking at the 7900 GRE strictly for VR, paying an extra $50 to $100 doesn't make a lot of sense when you consider the 7800 XT offers almost identical VR performance. In reality, though, I don't think anyone is going to be using this, or any other GPU for that matter, strictly for VR. And it does offer a decent uplift in performance over the 7800 XT in regular flat games. So, in reality, it's not a bad investment. And on top of that, AMD's driver woes when it comes to VR are now squarely in the rearview mirror. I didn't have to do any troubleshooting or tweaking when doing this testing like I had to do with the 7900 XTX and a couple other Radeon 7000 GPUs after they first came out. I simply slotted the card in, installed the drivers, and started playing. So that is a very good thing. Come on, do it. You know you want to. Subscribe!